So no more saying, if you eat your meal, I'm going to give you candy, or I'm going to give you an ice cream after that. Hi everyone, and welcome to Ask Me Doctor Season 3, a health video series for you and your family. I'm Syahira from Motherhood.com.my. Now imagine you prepared a full spread of delicious food or dinner only to have your child turn their nose up at everything on their plate. You try to coax them to try just one thing, you guide their imaginary aeroplane spoon into their mouth, and food just ends up everywhere except their tummies. And it starts to escalate into a full-blown battle to get them to eat. Now does that sound familiar? Well, today we're honored to have Dr. JoAnn Raja, a pediatrician from Firststep Child Specialist Clinic, to help us out with our sticky situations with our picky eaters. Hi, Dr. JoAnn.
Hi there, Syahira.
Welcome back once again. We're always so happy to have you.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Oh, okay. So we have a lot of interesting questions lined up for you. When you're ready, shall we get started?
Sure. Let's start.
Awesome. So my first question for you is, maybe you can explain to us what is picky eating and how do I know if I have a picky eater?
Sure. So first and foremost, there's actually no universal definition for picky eaters. However, children who are picky eaters share common characteristics such as the unwillingness to try new food or even familiar food. And of course, they also have very strong food preferences. So there would definitely come a time where every toddler will experience some form of food preference. It is normal, and eventually the child will outgrow this phase. However, some children may have very limited food choices, and that can be a problem if it goes on long term. So some of the signs that you may be dealing with a picky eater include a child who is eating a limited amount of food, refusing food, particularly fruits and vegetables, unwilling to try new foods, or accepting only few types of food, preferring drinks over food, and of course having strong food preferences.
Okay, could you explain to us why my child is so fussy with food?
Sure, so children can be picky eaters for many reasons. A young child is developing their sense of autonomy, so they may prefer to feed themselves and start choosing the food they eat. There are some children who are more sensitive to taste, smell and texture. So while some children may prefer soft foods, others might prefer crunchy textures.
Depends on the individual.
Yeah, it depends on individual. Now the next would be late introduction of complementary foods, especially lumpy foods, can also affect a child's food acceptance later on.
What do you consider as
Okay, so when we talk about introducing complementary food, it should be introduced at 6 months.
6 months, all right.
So no delaying there unless the doctor has already advised for you to delay complementary foods due to certain issues, for example, prematurity, or if the child has any underlying neurological issues such as difficulty in swallowing, things like that.
Okay.
Yeah. So if in a normal child, in a very healthy child, complementary food should be introduced by 6 months onwards.
Noted.
So picky eating habits are also more likely to develop when parents punish, bribe, or reward their children's eating behaviors. So no more saying, if you eat your meal, I'm going to give you candy, or I'm going to give you an ice cream after that. So this does not work for children. I know you're laughing there. Have you ever done that before?
Well, not me, but I remember my aunts and uncles used to do that to us.
Yeah.
No rewarding.
Okay. Yeah. And some children also develop unhealthy eating habits by modeling their parents' eating habits. Just like the phrase, monkey see,
monkey do.
Yeah.
All right, so I'll move on to my next question. So will picky eating affect my child and should I worry?
Yeah. So the good news, parents, is that picky eating also consists of a spectrum. So if a child dislikes certain food, but still eats a good variety of other food, then this will unlikely cause any impact on the child's growth.
So then for that reason, you don't have to worry as long as that just means that...
Yeah, this just means that it's a phase that they will eventually overcome.
Okay.
However, for children at the extreme end of the spectrum, the limited or lack of food consumed can actually affect the child's growth. So do take note of these red flags in children, especially those with feeding difficulties. So number one, if there's any difficulty or pain during swallowing, so that's not normal. if there's any coughing or choking during feeding? Does the child get frequent episodes of lung infection? Is the child falling off the growth charts? Are there any other symptoms such as vomiting or diarrhea? So I believe that parents should always refer to their doctors if they have any concerns about their child's eating patterns or behavior.
Right. Yeah, when in doubt, always seek professional help, right?
Yes. We're always, you know, more than happy to help you.
Great. So your parents out there, take note. Don't be scared. Okay, so my next question for you, we'll move on with, how can I help improve my child's eating habits?
Sure. So this is a very good and relevant question. So good eating habits need to be cultivated in every child. So some of the important mealtime rules that parents should take note of include avoiding distractions during meals. This includes putting away toys, books, switching off the TV, and any other forms of diversions.
So is that so that the child can fully focus on the meal, right?
Yes. Okay. Right. And next is to have regular meal time. So feed children at regular times and space the meals and snacks by 2 to 3 hours apart. So in between, offer only water so that there would be enough space in their little tummy to accommodate their meals.
Yeah, it makes sense because even us adults, if we have water with our meals, we just end up bloated.
Yeah.
So if it applies to us, then it applies to children as
definitely.
Well, of course.
Definitely, yeah. So the next would be give realistic food portions. So sometimes we parents may overestimate how much our children should actually take. So keep portions small, roughly the size of their fist and not ours, yeah? But allow your child to also ask for additional helpings whenever they want to. So next would be limit meal times. Yeah. So parents will sometimes tend to prolong meal times, even up to 1 hour. So much so that, you know, their child will finish everything on their plate. However, that will only make meal times draggy and reduces your child's enthusiasm. So keep meal times roughly about 20 to 30 minutes maximum, even if your child has eaten very little or did not finish the meal.
And don't force the kid, I think, right?
Yes.
Don't force your children to eat.
Try your very best to never force your kids to eat.
Yeah? Be encouraging with, do you think encouraging
yes.
words and all that would help as well?
Encouraging definitely would work, and especially encourage independent eating in children.
Right.
So children need to use all their 5 senses to enjoy their food. So encourage independent eating and just close an eye to the mess that they make. Alright, so next we'll be keeping neutral and encourage good behavior at all times. So despite how frustrated you are, keep your emotions in check and remain neutral. Give praises whenever your child feeds himself and avoid using food to treat or reward your child, right? So no more saying that if you eat your meals, I'm going to give you ice cream or I'm going to give you candy, alright?
No, no more saying that, parents.
Yeah. And do also gently teach your child to remain seated at the table during meal times. So I think in order to do this, it will be a very good habit to eat together as a family.
Right. Yeah. I try to implement that with my baby as well. Because I do notice when we're eating together, then she can really focus on her food. Because she's seeing us eating. So when she sees us eating, her mouth will sort of like, even before feeding, her mouth goes up, mum, mum.
Yeah.
Because, you know, babies like to imitate.
Yes, they love to imitate adults.
Yeah. So yeah, that's a good tip. Okay. So is there anything else that I can do to help my child with their nutritional intake?
Yeah. So one of the ways that you can increase a picky eater's nutritional intake is to serve nutrient-dense meals. What it means is to offer your child foods that pack lots of nutrients in smaller doses. So some nutrient-dense food that most children are willing to eat include avocados, broccoli, peanut butter, ooh, I love those, tofu, Greek yogurt, potatoes, cheese, sweet potatoes, and many more.
And they also sound so yummy.
Yeah, they sound so yummy, indeed. So vitamins and mineral supplementation may be considered if the child's diet lacks nutrients.
Right.
So choose one that has essential vitamins such as vitamin A, vitamin B5 and B6, vitamin B12, vitamin D, vitamin E, and minerals such as iron, folic acid, iodine, and zinc.
All the essential vitamins that they need, right?
Yes.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Dr. JoAnn, for helping us with our picky eaters today. Besides these questions, do you have anything that you want to share with parents out there?
All right, so no matter how fussy a child might be while eating, I feel don't try to turn mealtime into a battlefield. Be a good role model, keep trying, and stay positive.
Yeah, I think it can be hard sometimes for parents out there, but just remember that as parents, you really, if you release that negative energy, it kind of goes on to your kid as well. So yeah. If you try to keep positive, your kid will be positive too. I think it's all about how we set ourselves as role models for our children, right?
That's true.
Okay, well, thank you again, Dr. JoAnn. It's always lovely speaking to you. And a special thanks to our sponsor, BioLife, for sponsoring this episode of Ask Me Doctor. As parents, we want to see our children grow healthily. BioLife's Kids Gummies, Multivitamins and Minerals is a fruity-flavored gummy that contains 8 essential vitamins and 2 different types of minerals. Multivitamins and minerals are needed for children's general well-being. Well, we hope that you enjoyed and learned from today's programs. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you again soon. Till next time, I'm Syahira.
And I'm Dr. JoAnn.
This is Motherhood.com.my.
Bye. Bye.